with the city. I think it's just a great project. We're just so pleased with the way that it looks. It was an exterior renovation and a lot of new siding, painting, a very complicated paint job, and we think it looks beautiful. So please check it out the next time you're in the park. This is not one of our revitalization projects, but it is what the park looked like today. I was calling it Lake Stewart, I guess, because it kind of surrounds the Mayor Stewart Memorial. So as you know, we had a lot of rain yesterday and I've never seen the park look like this. So I just wanted to share this with you because it's I think going down quickly. The playground fared pretty well, but Ithaca had some big flooding yesterday and it certainly happened in Stewart Park and I'm sure in Cass Park as well. So we want to, the presentation today really predates 1921 and it's really about Renwick Park, and the park was started as a trolley park by the Ithaca Street Railway. And they put a lot of money and created a beautiful facility, much of which is still there today and we're working to restore. You can see a view from the lake of the pavilion complex, the dance pavilion, the picnic pavilion, which we still use as picnic pavilion, the water tower. And what we'll be focusing on today is this band shell where music happened there. Next to the band shell, this really beautiful band shell was the Wharton Studio, a silent film production company that thrived right here in Ithaca between 1914 and 1920. The Wharton brothers produced hundreds of films starring some of the best known actors of the day, including Creighton Hale, Pearl White, Lionel Barrymore, and even a young Oliver Hardy before his breakthrough with Laurel and Hardy. October, as I'm sure you all know, is a silent film month here in Ithaca. And the Wharton Studio is a co-sponsor of this evening's event. So we thought it fitting to highlight the music of Patrick Conway and his famous Ithaca Band during this month of October when we're celebrating this great history of silent film production in Ithaca. And this was the time when hundreds and hundreds of people on a nightly, throughout the summer months, flocked to Stewart Park to hear great music on this band shell as viewed here from that beautiful water tower. So with that, the sun has just set in Stewart Park, so have your wine and please enjoy Corey. Corey will share some of his images. Thank you for coming. Enjoy the show.
Thank you, Rick, and welcome everyone. Great to see some familiar names and some new names on the attendee list. Thanks for joining us tonight for this presentation. I'm honored to be speaking as part of the Stewart Park Centennial Festivities and during Silent Movie Month in Ithaca. And today's presentation, as Rick said, ties into both of those themes as we talk about Patrick Conway. Stewart Park is such a wonderful community resource, and it's one that several generations of my family have enjoyed over the years. And I love to spend time there myself, watching the sunset on the benches near the willows. It's just a great community place. For those who don't know me, I'm Corey Ryan Earle. I work at Cornell University in Alumni Affairs and Development, but I also serve as sort of the de facto university historian, and I teach a class at Cornell of about 400, 500 students each spring semester on the history of Cornell University, although last year it was 1,000 students because it was on Zoom and we weren't limited by room size. And some of you know, over the last year and a half or so, I've given over 115 Zoom presentations on aspects of local history and Cornell history. But this is one aspect that I haven't talked a lot about, the musical history of Ithaca. So I'm happy to cover that tonight. For those of you who might be interested in learning about some of the other topics that I've shared in different presentations, I'm going to put a link in the chat. And that's a link to a website with recordings of all sorts of past local history presentations, Cornell history presentations. And I will be sure to post the link to tonight's recording there afterwards as well, if you're looking to rewatch or if you missed part of it. My personal interest in tonight's topic comes from a combination of my interest in local history and my interest in local music. I've been involved with the History Center in Tompkins County for many years as a volunteer board member and board president, and really a wonderful resource. Some of the images in today's presentation come from the History Center in Tompkins County. And then I'm also involved in a couple of local music organizations, the Cornell University Glee Club. I was a member of as a student, and I serve as their board president now of their alumni board, and also the Dryden Area Intergenerational Band and Chorus. I was a founding member of that organization over 25 years ago, and now serve on their board as well. So involved in history and music, and Patrick Conway is a great combination of the two. So let's get started. I mean, Ithaca is known for its music scene. Ithaca has major events like Grassroots and Porch Fest, world-renowned faculty and music programs at both Ithaca College and Cornell University. We've been the home to many nationally recognized artists like Ex-Ambassadors or John Brown's Body or a Sim Redman Band, Samus, countless others. But today we're going to be talking about one of the first people to put Ithaca on the map musically, someone who had a major impact locally and nationally, and whose legacy is still visible today in many ways. And Patrick Conway also had important connections to both Cornell University and Ithaca College, these two major institutions that play a role locally. He is not as much of a household name as maybe he should be. And so today we'll talk about why I think maybe Patrick Conway should be better known, at least within the Ithaca community, because he did have a pretty significant legacy. Now, I imagine many of you have seen The Music Man, either on stage or in film, the Broadway musical that was a hit in 1957, followed by a film version in 1962, starring Robert Preston. But probably the best known song from The Music Man is the song 76 Trombones. And if you listen carefully to the lyrics of 76 Trombones, they actually mention Patrick Conway. They mention an Ithacan. And so I'm going to play you a little snippet and you can hear this part of the song.
And you feel something akin to the electric thrill I once enjoyed when Gilmore, Liberati, Pat Conway, the great creator, W.C. Handy, and John Philip Sousa all came to town on the very same historic day.
So that's part of the intro into the song 76 Trombones, and he names, the music man names several famous band leaders, John Philip Sousa probably being the name you're most likely to recognize, the best known of those. But this is set during 1912, and 1912 is sort of the peak of big community bands, of professional bands. Bands were the main entertainment. These names were the pop stars of the music world. These were very recognizable names at the time. And you heard Patrick Gilmore, Giuseppe Creator, W.C. Handy, John Philip Sousa, and then Pat Conway as our local name. And many of these aren't as much household names today as they were then, besides Sousa. And one of the reasons that is that Sousa was an incredibly prolific composer on top of being a band leader. While the others were more known as band leaders, Sousa left this legacy afterwards that probably impacted his memory today because he wrote so many pieces. For instance, he composed 137 marches, 15 operettas, 5 overtures, 11 suites, 24 dances, 28 fantasies, and made 322 band arrangements. So very prolific, and bands over the generations have continued to perform his music and kept his name as a household name, while the others, their fame was not as lasting because they weren't major composers like Sousa. But Gilmore, Conway, and Sousa were all inaugural members of the National Band Association Hall of Fame. They are all enshrined in this Hall of Fame for their role in the history of band music. So let's learn a little bit about Conway. Conway was born in Troy, New York, not that far from Tompkins County. And he was born the same year Cornell University was founded, 1865, for some local context. He moved to Homer, New York, near Cortland as an infant. Moving closer to Tompkins County. And he picked up a cornet at a pretty young age, decided he was interested in music. He was working in a carriage factory in Homer at the time, picked up a cornet and started performing locally in ensembles. And at the time there was a Homer cornet band in the 1870s and 1880s, which was considered, quote, one of the best bands in central New York and, quote, one of the very best musical organizations in the entire state. So a popular band that would perform around upstate New York. And he played in that for a little while. The band eventually disbanded for financial reasons, and he took over the Cortland Band. And Cortland was a pretty musical community at this point. Gilmore and Sousa both visited in the 1880s and 1890s with their bands. So nationally prominent musicians were coming through town. And the other thing to remember is that bands were the main form of entertainment during this era, the late 19th century, early 20th century. There were no TVs or movies or Netflix, but bands were the popular form of entertainment. These ensembles would come through town and perform, and that was what you would do on your weekend. You would go watch a band. And this was the era of big community bands, of firemen's conventions that would have bands compete and perform at them, parades, competitions. And these events would attract 10,000 up to 25,000 people when there would be one of these big band conventions or events that would bring performers from all over. So it was a major part of social life and entertainment during this era. And here you can see a poster for the Homer Cornett Band performing at the Cortland Opera House. And there's Conway with his cornet. And in 1894, Conway was invited to bring his Cortland Band to Ithaca. The Central New York Volunteer Firemen's Association convention was happening in Ithaca in 1894. And here you can see a photo of that event. This is on North Cayuga Street, near State Street, the big parade as part of the firemen's convention. And there were lots of bands that would march in the parade and perform as part of these conventions. And it just so happened in 1894 that two of the judges for the band competition as part of this convention were two particularly important names in Ithaca, New York. And you might recognize them. The one on the left is Ebenezer Treeman. The one on the right is Hollis Dan. And Ebenezer Treeman, the patriarch of a family that was very important in Ithaca. We have Treeman Park and Treeman Marina named after other members of the family, but they ran the banks, the utilities. They were all trustees of Cornell University, very prominent local family. And Ebenezer was one of the major patrons of the arts in Ithaca, a big supporter of music, theater in Ithaca, New York. Hollis Stan, on the other hand, came to Ithaca to create the music program in the high school. In Ithaca High School, he was the founder of the music program, music education in Ithaca, went on to be one of the leaders at the Ithaca Conservatory of Music that became Ithaca College. He served on their board. He went on to start the music department at Cornell University, was the founding professor when it became a department. Founded the Cornell University Glee Club, or was the first professional conductor of it, took over a sort of ragtag student organization, and went on to national prominence in public school education, music education in public schools. But he's an entire presentation on his own. But he and Treeman were judging this competition, and they approached Conway afterwards. He was 29 years old, so still a relatively young man. And they made him a threefold job offer. They offered him three different jobs if he would move to Ithaca. And it was a pretty good deal, these three jobs. And so the first of the jobs was at Cornell University. They offered him the Cornell Cadet Band, which was the major instrumental music ensemble at Cornell University at the time. This was the predecessor of the Big Red Marching Band. The band began as part of ROTC, the military program at Cornell. And for the first 100 years of Cornell's history, almost all male students were required to participate in mandatory military drill. They would participate in ROTC originally for 2 years, later dropped to 1 year, and then that requirement went away in 1960. But the band tradition came out of this military band, this cadet band. And Patrick Conway became the very first non-student director of what became the Cornell Marching Band. In 1895, he took over and conducted them for just over a decade, but began to turn them into a legitimate musical organization, the first time they had a professional musician helping out. And he took them to Elmira, New York. They actually toured, one of the first Cornell musical ensembles to travel. And here's the program for a concert at the Elmira Opera House. Shortly after he took over, he brings the Cornell University Cadet Band to perform. And this is before there really was an orchestra at Cornell or a wind ensemble. The main competition in terms of music at Cornell was the Glee Banjo and Mandolin Club, which included the Glee Club as a vocal ensemble, and then the Banjo and Mandolin Clubs that they toured with as the main instrumental ensembles at Cornell. But the cadet band was the wind ensemble. So Conway begins that. So that's part of his legacy. The Cornell Marching Band today is part of Conway's legacy. The second part of Conway's job offer in 1894 was to join the new Ithaca Conservatory of Music. This conservatory was founded in 1892, a small music school, and they wanted to have a brass teacher, someone who could teach brass instruments at this new conservatory. And at the time, brass music was pretty unheard of at colleges. It wasn't something that was regularly taught. This was somewhat unusual that they wanted to have a brass instructor. And he was paid about $20 per semester on a per pupil basis. And that was his contract with Ithaca College. And here you can see the faculty list for the Ithaca Conservatory in 1899, with Patrick Conway listed there for band and orchestra. And you might recognize a few other names on this list. For instance, Joseph Hickey. Those of you who have spent time in Ithaca are probably familiar with Hickey's Music Store. Joseph Hickey was the founder of Hickey's Music, was also on the early faculty of the Ithaca Conservatory. And if you look in the upper left, you have the executive committee of the school, the sort of board leading the school. And you have Charles Treeman, the cousin of Ebenezer Treeman, the part of the Treeman family that recruited Conway to town. And you have Hollis Dann, that other individual who recruited Conway, who would go on to start the music program at Cornell. So interesting Ithaca-Cornell connections between this group. And here's an early program. This is an 1895 program for the Ithaca Conservatory of Music at a concert locally. And you can see there was a performance by Mr. P. Conway, Fantasia for Cornet. So he's performing cornet solos after joining the young school at this point. And then the third part of Conway's job offer was to take over the Ithaca Band, the community band in Ithaca. So he was leading the community band in Cortland, and he's asked, will you take over the Ithaca community band and revitalize it? And this was an organization that Ebenezer Treeman was a big supporter of, really wanted to see it grow into prominence. And this was a time period when these bands were really becoming a major thing nationally. Conway takes over and begins leading this Ithaca band. And here that's Conway on the left leading the Ithaca band. And they began performing at these firemen's conventions and band competitions. Ithaca actually hosted the Ithaca Band Fair in 1898 and brought bands from all over to Ithaca. And many of these performers, members of the band, held other jobs. This wasn't a full-time role. But gradually, as the band began to get more national attention, more attention beyond Ithaca, the group began to attract professional musicians. And this turned into a professional ensemble that had a full-time touring schedule where it was traveling beyond Ithaca pretty regularly. But that took time. It wasn't immediately after Conway took over, but within a decade or so, the heyday of this sort of golden era of bands begins, and Conway is traveling around the country with the Ithaca Band. And Conway took over the band in the same year that Renwick Park opened. Renwick Park being the predecessor of Stewart Park, opens in 1894. And here you can see the Cascadilla Boathouse. But this original park, Renwick, was a lakeside park owned by the trolley company with a pier and pavilions. You saw some of Rick's photos earlier showing the park in those early years. And the just opened Cascadilla Boathouse. This was under construction in those first few years when Renwick Park opened. And Conway and his band were contracted by the trolley company to play at this new Renwick Park. And here's the photo of that bandstand at Renwick Park. And the trolley company paid Conway to bring people as an entertainment, as an amusement at this amusement park in Ithaca. And he would bring crowds. He grew the Ithaca Band into this major ensemble that was a big attraction for the people of Ithaca. And this concert, here's a concert program from 1901 with him performing at Renwick Beach, it says on here, with the Ithaca Prize Band. The name of the band would evolve with time as it won awards. It begins being called the Ithaca Prize Band. And as its popularity grows beyond Ithaca, you'll see that the name Ithaca gradually disappears from the band when it's credited. It becomes Conway's Band or Patrick Conway and his famous band, and the Ithaca name gradually disappears, but it's still the Ithaca Prize Band as of 1901 performing at Renwick Beach. And here's a program from 1923. So more than 20 years later, Stewart Park, Renwick Park remained an important home base for Conway. And he plays there just a couple of years after Stewart Park opens. Remained his home throughout his career before his fame with the Ithaca Band and after he'd achieved significant national fame. And if you look at the different songs being performed on the programs, his repertoire hasn't changed that much. He mostly performed a fairly classical repertoire with some contemporary marches in there, but not a lot of evolution between the 1901 concert and the 1923 concert at Stewart Park. And you can see the name evolved from Ithaca Prize Band to Conway's Band in 1923. And during the heyday of Conway's time in Ithaca, it's clear he was a key figure in the local music scene, not just in Ithaca, but in the county as well. Here's a program with Conway conducting the Trumansburg Band. So he was conducting beyond just the Ithaca Band, and it notes that he is the leader of the Ithaca Band, but going beyond Ithaca, other areas of the county as well, performing in Trumansburg at the Opera Hall. And here's an article from 1904. Even with a growing national reputation, it was still difficult for bands to be financially successful. And Conway's national reputation is beginning to grow at this point, but he actually writes an open letter to the Cornell community and explains the band's budget situation. This is published in the Cornell Daily Sun, the student newspaper. And he explains in this letter, it would cost $4,000 to run the Ithaca Band for the next 3 years. And in today's dollars, that's a little under $120,000 or so, or $30,000 a year to run the band. And he notes that the local community had subscribed $3,200, and he asked Cornellians to make up the remaining $800. And he says in this letter, if $800 is raised, the Ithaca Band will be at the disposal of the undergraduate body four more times during the coming college year. And with each additional $50 that students raised, he would give an additional performance too. So he basically says, I will be at your disposal, perform at campus events if Cornellians can chip in and help support the local community band. And he did become a pretty key fixture in the Cornell music and entertainment scene too. And so he, beyond just doing the cadet band, the marching band, he was performing at the balls and proms that were happening at Cornell. These often took place at the old Armory building on the engineering quad today, but that building was torn down in the 1950s, a predecessor of Barton Hall. And you can see there's a little bandstand over the crowd here. That was where the band would perform for these gala events on campus. But he would also perform at football games and baseball games and crew regattas downtown. He would bring the Ithaca Band to whatever event that students would have him at. And one of the more unique ones was he would perform at the ice carnivals held on BB Lake. Here you can see the setup for an ice carnival on BB Lake. They're putting up the little carnival area. You can note there's a primitive Zamboni on the ice, a horse-drawn ice clearer there. And here's an advertisement for the Junior Week Ice Carnival, circa early 20th century here, which notes that there will be music and entertainment. And here's a photo of what those ice carnivals looked like where Conway would provide the music. Here's an ad for one of them that notes that the Ithaca Band will be part of it. Fireworks and the Ithaca Band, refreshments, admission 75 cents. And in 1908, he was paid $50 for the ice carnival. So that was about the going rate for the Ithaca Band for these local events during that time period. But Conway begins to tour nationally at this point, the early 20th century. And he takes the Ithaca Band beyond Ithaca and really builds its reputation nationally. He performed at the state fairs in New York, Wisconsin, Iowa, Texas, Minnesota, Nebraska, Kansas, Utah, and Indiana. So really all over, not just one part of the country. He performed at the St. Louis World's Fair, Young's Pier in Atlantic City, the Cincinnati Zoo, the Canadian National Exhibition, the Corn Palace in South Dakota, the Pan American Exposition. So all over the place, he's getting invitations. And in some cases, it's a standing invitation where he would, you know, camp out at this location for several weeks or months at a time, spend the summer at a particular venue. He played opening days for the New York Giants baseball season at the Polo Grounds in New York City. In 1915, he had a 10-week engagement at the Panama Pacific Exposition in San Francisco. And those were the sort of engagements that really helped pay the bills when you're being paid for 10 weeks. Performing at one location, you're not having to pay for a lot of travel in between these events. But the 19 teens were really the glory days for the Ithaca Band, with it traveling all over the country. And he'd stopped conducting the Cornell Cadet Band in 1908 so he could focus on the Ithaca Band and its travels. And his appearances in Ithaca became more like celebrity visits. He really wasn't based locally during this era, begins to travel much more. And he found other jobs during non-touring season. He actually moved to Syracuse during the non-touring season and conducted the Syracuse Symphony Orchestra from 1910 to 1916, and also was a pit orchestra conductor at a Syracuse theater, working with vaudeville performers, and begins accompanying silent films during the height of their popularity in the 19-teens as well. Most theaters begin showing silent films and would hire orchestras and local musicians to provide the accompaniment for these films. And so Conway gets involved in that, and he does that again later. I'll talk a little bit more about that when he returns to Ithaca. But one of the problems during this era was the trolley company that owned Renwick Park actually got rather annoyed at him, because any performance not at the park was taking away attendance from their events. They were somewhat perturbed that his fame had grown and he was performing elsewhere. And he also ran into some other issues occasionally. There's one story of him traveling to Auburn to perform, and he was arrested on stage after the local clergy made a fuss about him performing on Sunday. And apparently there were some blue laws about performing and entertainment on Sundays, and the local clergy had him arrested for that particular incident. I think it was worked out later, but an embarrassing incident in Conway's career. But he became so famous that other people even wrote songs in honor of Conway. Here's a march from 1903, the Ithaca March, written by Roland Seitz. And you can see at the top, it says dedicated to Patrick Conway, director of the famous Ithaca Band of Ithaca, New York. So another evidence of Conway's growing reputation. But Conway himself only wrote one song. Unlike Sousa, who wrote these hundreds of pieces, Conway's only composition that survived today is a march called The Observing Visitor. And it's in honor of an individual named Ed Howe, who was a columnist for the Saturday Morning Post, who used The Observing Visitor as his pen name. And so I'll play a little clip of that so you get a sense of the music of the time and a bit of a sense of Conway's own compositional style. So that gives you an idea of what these concerts sounded like back in the day. And that's the Observing Visitor March by Patrick Conway. But what happens in the 19-teens? World War I happens, and the touring bands have to pause some of their activity. Many of the musicians have to pause their careers. But Conway's musical career did continue during the war. He actually received a captain's commission in 1916 to lead musical activity for the new branch of the US Army called the Air Service. And he ends up going to Camp MacArthur in Waco, Texas. And he's in charge of putting together the first band program for what would become the US Air Force, the predecessor of the Air Force. And does that during the war, helps with some musical activity. And then the Conway Band returns to touring after the war. Early band leaders did not do a lot of recording. That was not something that many of them liked to do. In fact, John Philip Sousa in particular disliked canned music, as he called it. He thought that the band should be heard live, and canned music was not the same thing. And Conway was one of the first people to begin recording, unlike some of his contemporaries. He worked with the Victor label and Edison label and put out albums with his band. And so here you see an ad for Conway's music, Conway's band on Victor Records. Here Conway's band on the Victrola. So he became a face of some of these early band recordings, and that helped his fame and popularity as well. He also experimented in another new medium, and that was radio. In 1927, he was on the national broadcast of the General Motors Family Hour radio show on the very first episode of General Motors Family Hour. And so one of his last performances was this performance on radio. And so he was someone who took advantage of new opportunities to perform and new opportunities to bring music to the public. But the last key piece of Conway's legacy that I'll talk about today is his legacy when he returned to Ithaca in the 1920s. And here's an article about him returning to Ithaca. This was headline news. He settles back in Ithaca in 1922, begins to slow his touring schedule. And he does this because he creates the Conway Military Band School. He founds this new institution to teach band music, to teach band future band leaders and conductors, and affiliates it with this Ithaca Conservatory of Music. And the Ithaca Conservatory had lots of small colleges and associations within it, these different schools that were affiliated with it in those early years. And so this was one of the units that became affiliated with the conservatory, and Conway returned as the dean of this new institution. And it's important to note the national context. The popularity of professional bands, of these touring bands, was beginning to wane in the 1920s. Movies were becoming more of a popular entertainment. Photographs, automobiles, all these other distractions were taking the place of the bands that previously were really the main form of entertainment. So his touring schedule was slowing down for other reasons too. And this was a new opportunity for him to focus on education instead of performing. And at the time, most musicians were self-taught or taught through correspondence schools. Musical education was not something being done in many places, certainly not band music education. And this was actually described as the first and only institute of its kind in the US. This was a unique thing, this Conway Military Band School. It was said that the school extends equal advantages to those who wish to be concert artists, orchestra or band conductors or soloists, and those who intend to be teachers. So those were the focus areas: concert performers, band conductors and leaders, soloists and teachers. And this institution, this band school, really laid the foundation for Ithaca College's really strong band tradition. That remains a very important component of Ithaca College's history today. And you can thank Patrick Conway for beginning that tradition at Ithaca College. Some of his students include Walter Beeler, a future band director at Ithaca College, Craig McHenry, a future dean of the Ithaca College School of Music, George Howard, who became the first director of the US Air Force Band, and even Les Brown, who went on to lead a famous dance band himself during the era of dance bands. So many notable students came out of Conway's band school when he was leading it. And public school music education begins to grow during this period as well. In the 1920s, public school music education is a growing field. And that's thanks in part to Hollis Dann, that individual I mentioned earlier. He becomes a major figure in state and national music curriculum development. And many of Conway's students go on to be public school band teachers. That was probably the most popular career choice for the graduates of his program, as public schools begin hiring band directors and focusing on instrumental music. Conway also continues judging competitions. He becomes a judge at various state band competitions. He leads the music at the New York State Fair in 1923. So he's still doing things beyond Ithaca and still conducting the Conway Band while leading the new military band school in Ithaca. And one of his last involvements was with silent films. And so in this photo, you'll notice this is in DeWitt Park in downtown Ithaca. And the buildings behind him, you might not recognize today, those buildings no longer exist, but those were the early buildings for Ithaca College down on Stewart Park. Most of Ithaca College was based in a series of buildings around the park before the college moved up South Hill. And so that one main building was the Music Hall, later known as the Little Theater for the Ithaca Conservatory or Ithaca College. And this building was there from 1913 to 1972, I believe. But briefly, in 1926, it was turned into a movie theater. It had a theater with 500 seats, and a noted theater owner in Syracuse leased the theater and had an arrangement with the school where he could operate a silent film theater out of the building in 1926. And it was under the management of this guy named Robbins from Syracuse. And Patrick Conway was hired to lead the orchestra for this theater, providing the accompaniment for silent films. And one description when it opened said, "Placed before the screen on the stage, following the original music score arranged for the picture and directed flawlessly by the famous director, the orchestra is not a thing taken for granted, a noise hidden in a pit. It brings a taste of the metropolitan." So the orchestra, the band was prominently placed in front of the screen so you could see them performing as you watched the movies. And this for 1 year in Ithaca, the Little Theater was offering movie entertainment with Conway leading. And yes, I mentioned that Stewart Park, or that's DeWitt Park, not Stewart Park. I apologize if I misspoke and call it Stewart, but this is DeWitt Park in the middle of town, not Stewart Park. So Conway's earlier performances were mostly at Stewart Park when he was hired by the trolley company, but this is his brief time in DeWitt Park leading the theater orchestra in 1926. And here you can see a couple ads for theaters that mentioned Patrick Conway's orchestra performing to film, Patrick Conway and his 25-piece orchestra performing to film. Conway continued to be a popular leader at the Ithaca Band School. The yearbook was dedicated to him at Ithaca in 1925 to Captain Patrick Conway in appreciation of his friendliness and of the inspiration of his genius. But he led the school for only 7 years, was not there for that long. Unfortunately, he passed away at age 64 following a prostate operation that didn't go well and died in 1929 while still leading the Conway School. By this point, the school had grown to around 80 students in 1929, so it wasn't huge, but a pretty sizable program that had grown into over the years. And this is the 1930 yearbook from Ithaca that had a little memorial to Conway. And it notes that he gave the world a name which will ever be classed with renowned band leaders. They sensed that he was really a national figure and that his name would be remembered. And as soon as he died, that the band school was actually renamed. They took his name off the school. The Ithaca Conservatory negotiated with his widow to take over the school completely, and it became the Ithaca Military Band School. And then in 1932, that was the year that Ithaca College was created. All these different affiliated schools with the Ithaca Conservatory merged together to form a new college called Ithaca College. And so the name sort of disappears at that point as a separate band school and is subsumed into this larger entity known as Ithaca College. There is a Patrick Conway scholarship given at Ithaca College that was actually organized by his daughter, Catherine, in 1978, and that still goes to a student pursuing band music, band education. So there's a little bit of a memorial and memory of Patrick Conway at Ithaca College. There was a plan for a public memorial to Conway in Ithaca in the 1930s. There was plans developed for a Conway Memorial Bandstand at Stewart Park. And $12,000 were actually designated under the auspices of the Works Progress Administration to build a beautiful new bandstand for Stewart Park that would be an entertainment venue for the city of Ithaca. But the funds ended up going toward other park maintenance and other projects, and the Conway Memorial never materialized beyond the planning stage. But there were plans for a special bandstand in his memory at one point. Conway's grave is nearby. I visited when I was preparing this presentation and took this photo a few weeks ago. This is in St. Mary's Cemetery in Cortland, so near Homer, where he grew up. He and his family are buried there. And his death was noted nationally. John Philip Sousa was quoted saying, "Mr. Conway enjoyed the respect of everybody in his profession." And this is coming from someone who was seen as kind of a rival to Conway. The two of them, although they did have an okay relationship, they were often competing for different gigs and performing opportunities and touring opportunities. So there was a bit of a rivalry there. And Conway's life really coincided almost exactly with the golden era of concert bands and professional bands as popular music and entertainment. He grew up as you know, small brass bands and cornet bands were taking off as the big entertainment. As his career matured, the era of professional bands happened, and his career coincided perfectly with their popularity. And at the time of his death, they were really dwindling and fading away. That era was closing. And so the timing aligned with his career pretty well. He left a major impact as an entertainer and as an educator, was a key figure alongside Sousa in this era of professional bands. And he was a significant influence on the next generation of musicians and the next generation of Ithaca College, really helped set the stage for the future of IC as a major musical institution and not just stringed instruments or vocal music, but he's the one who laid the foundation for band music at Ithaca College. And if you want to learn more about Conway, I highly recommend this book. A lot of the material today comes from this book. This is Patrick Conway and His Famous Band by Dr. Mark Fonder. Dr. Fonder taught at Ithaca College from 1989 to 2015 and continued Conway's legacy and was really a steward of that legacy at Ithaca College when he taught the concert band there, directed it. And so he did a lot of research on Conway's life and history and published this book in 2012. So if you want to learn more, you can find that book at various online retailers and highly recommend checking it out if you'd like to learn more about Conway and his famous band. And so with that, I will leave some time for Q&A. Feel free to chime in the chat if you'd like, or you can use the Q&A feature. I saw we got one question earlier, is the present day Ithaca Concert Band a descendant of the Conway Band? And the present band wasn't formed until 1976. So it's a more recent iteration of the community band legacy in Ithaca. So not a direct descendant, but certainly inspired by Conway and his Ithaca Band as the first major community band in Ithaca. But happy to answer any other questions that folks might have about Conway or other local history that maybe I can answer.
Thank you, Corey. I think Janelle may pop in here and...
He answered the one question that I had fielded other than your questions, okay. Rick. So I'll have you ask your questions.
Okay, well, we can do that. My video isn't showing up, but maybe it is for everyone else. I have no idea.
I can see you just Corey, fine.
That was great, Corey. Thank you so much. That was totally fascinating. So I do have a couple questions. Does he have like written transcriptions that are available for, I don't know, purchase, or can you find them? Or I'm just wondering about his arrangements and if they're unique or...
So Conway didn't do a lot of arranging himself. He did amass a large library of music for the Ithaca, the band, Conway's band. And unfortunately, almost all of that was destroyed in a fire shortly after his death. There was a bad fire that destroyed the collection, the archives of the Ithaca Concert Band. And so most of the music that Conway himself had collected was destroyed in that. According to Fonder's book, there are some copies of the music that are still stamped with Conway's band on it in the Ithaca College Music Library. But a lot of the early music has disappeared, or at least the actual sheet music that they used. So we get the best sense of what they performed from the concert programs over the years, not from the sheet music.
I'm curious, what is it that... set him apart? Was it just the quality of the musicians or the quality of the arrangements or showmanship? Or I don't know, I'm just curious.
Yeah, that's a good question. And I don't know if I have a good answer for that. I think certainly he had the right personality, I think, for it. I think he had a bit of showmanship to him and could put on a good show and inspired his musicians to want to travel and be part of this group. It was a group that had loyalty to him. There are some who said he had a bit of a temper, but I think for the most part was a pretty well-liked guy. And so, yeah, I think it was probably a combination of the caliber of the music and the quality of showmanship and his willingness also to get his name out there, you know, as one of the first band leaders who did record make albums and get the name out there that way, who did perform on a radio as that was a new medium. So I think those things helped get his name out there too.
Right. This brings us to the next two questions that people have asked. One person asks if the musicians typically held day jobs. And the other question was, are there recordings of Conway Band performances? Do they have them out there either at CU or IC or somewhere else? I personally know of one place where they can be found, but I'll let you answer that first, Corey.
Yeah, so the question about day jobs, originally that most of the musicians in these community bands did have day jobs. They weren't fully professional ensembles. Conway really grew the Ithaca Band into a fully professional ensemble. And it was difficult to hold a day job when you were touring around the country. Most of them would take jobs in the off season. So they would travel during the summer, for instance, and be based somewhere at a exposition or fair, whatever it may be. And then maybe take a winter job or during the off season have jobs performing in other pit orchestras or theater ensembles, accompanying silent films, those sort of things. And then the question about, are there recordings? I believe there are recordings that you can find of Conway's band, since he did perform on radio and make albums. So I imagine both IC and Cornell, I don't know for sure, I haven't checked their library holdings, but I imagine they both hold some. Janelle, do you know?
When doing some of my own research for Friends of Stewart Park, I found that there's actually recordings of both Conway's band and other people playing Conway's band music on YouTube. There's quite a few. So if you search for Patrick Conway, the Ithaca Band, and other things like that, you will find some recordings on YouTube.
There you go. So you can check that out. And you can also find that recording I played earlier of the Observing Visitor March that Conway himself wrote. That's on YouTube also. So that's from an old album recording of that someone has uploaded to YouTube. Someone asked if Walter Buehler is related to Joan Buehler, the Ithaca Concert Band's first director. I wouldn't be surprised, but I don't know personally. I bet someone else does though. So if someone knows in the chat, feel free to chime in. And then I see Peggy asked, when did the banjo and mandolin clubs die out? What happened to all those fine instruments? Great question, Peggy. And so the Glee banjo and mandolin clubs, these main musical ensembles at Cornell, they toured together pretty regularly through the 1920s into the 1930s. I think by the end of the 30s, they begin to die out. There are other instrumental music ensembles that sort of take the place of the banjo and mandolin clubs, and that sort of style of music is dying out. The Glee Club, of course, spun off as its own thing, performing separately from them and still going today. But I don't know what happened to all those nice banjos and mandolins. I assume students took them with them as they graduated. I do know in that fire that destroyed some of Conway's music, that there were instruments destroyed in that fire as well. So probably some of the early instruments used by the Conway band.
Well, that's a perfect segue to my question. So I play bluegrass music and love it. And I've read some histories of Bill Monroe, kind of founded the music. He was a mandolin player. And of course, banjo was very prominent in his kind of defining what the bluegrass music was. And the whole traveling part of it is really interesting. Just how did you think about that time period when the roads were terrible, there were no interstates. And this probably is a question that you may not have an answer to, but it's intriguing to me. Just how did they rent a bus, or how did they get around? I wonder, like all these, and Bill Monroe had they had a big old car or station wagon, and they fit five guys with a bass strapped to the roof, you know, but how would a band like Patsy Conway's get to Indiana, I wonder?
Most of these groups usually traveled by train. The Glee Club, Conway's band, they would rent a few rail cars and load up their instruments and take off by train. And that was the main form for touring ensembles like this. There are lots of stories I know of the Cornell Glee Club's touring days and various shenanigans and mishaps when they would travel by train, or half the club would end up in one city and the other half in another city when some accident happened. So I think that was the main source of travel.
That's great. That's
good. And in the Lehigh Valley Railroad, there was a traveling passenger agent. That was his title, named Frank Wingert, who was known as Frank Lehigh as his nickname. But he was sort of the guy who would coordinate with student groups for traveling for football games or whatever athletic event. The Glee Banjo and Mandolin Clubs would coordinate him. I imagine he also worked with Conway's band and would set up the arrangements for their travel, train cars, and make sure they got to the right spot. So there was a railway employee who would make sure things worked out, sort of a local personality.
Huh, interesting. Is there anything else, Janelle, that you are observing in your...
The only other note was that Edward O'Rourke had an interesting note about, said that touring was a drawback for musician jobs because it took them away from home and was seasonal. Said that many musicians settled in towns that they visited and started teaching because the work was steadier there. And that the touring bands traveled by train, which was, I didn't even think about that, but yeah, it's so smart.
Yeah. Okay, well, I guess maybe that wraps it up, I guess. So thank you, Corey. This was an amazingly great ending to our series. That was fascinating and so relevant to Stewart Park. And thank you for sharing this with us. It was really, really great. We appreciate it.
Thank you, my pleasure. Thanks everyone for joining.
Yeah, and it will be, this was recorded. Maybe, I'm sure the body of it at least was recorded. Maybe there might've been a slight glitch at the beginning, which is totally my fault. But Corey's presentation was recorded. So we will have that up on the website probably in a week or maybe less.
Yeah, we'll have that on our YouTube page, and we will also send out the link to people who signed up for it and ask them to pass it on to others who may be interested.
Yeah, great. Well, thank you, Janelle, and thank you, Corey. And we will we'll be in touch with all of you about a carousel presentation after the holidays. And thank you so much.
Thanks. Good night.
All right. Thanks, Corey. Thank you all for coming.